Hello everyone and welcome to my channel Cyber Satrics. My name is Santosh and in today's session we're gonna discuss about Splunk lookups. So lookup is a very simple concept, but I've seen many professionals struggling to understand this concept and its usage in the real time. Lookup is very much similar to the reference set in Curadar's SimTool. The advantage being the lookup has a higher advantage than reference set because it's very dynamic and it's having a very vast usage in Splunk, which can make your life very easier and your task also very simple. So let us see what is today's agenda. In today's session, we're gonna cover the lookup concept and its overview. We're gonna discuss about the search time sequence. It implies when we have multiple operation being performed on a search, at what priority does the lookup comes at? Okay, we're gonna see in coming slides. Next, we're gonna discuss about lookup table files. Every lookup is always associated with three things. One is lookup table files, lookup definition, and automatic lookup. I'll explain in the further slides. Next, we're gonna discuss about the search commands. Okay, which we're gonna use during the hands-on based on this lookup concept. One is your input lookup, output lookup, and there's something called as lookup, which is basically utilized to enrich your data, which is already stored on the Splunk. Okay, we're gonna see all this based on the practical examples and on the real-time logs. Okay, so starting with lookup overview or lookup definition and concept. So lookup basically a concept which is used to enrich the event data. When I say event data, it implies the data which is already being stored in the Splunk or already logged in the Splunk. Okay, so defining lookup, it is a concept which is used to enrich the event data by adding field value combination from the lookup table files or any external data. Right, so this is basically what a lookup is. Many professionals who has idea about SQL or students also who has have idea about SQL, they can associate it with the something called as primary key in SQL, right? Which is the primary key is used to associate or correlate between two different tables in a database, right? In the same way, let us consider we have a CSV lookup table file which consists of host name and its respective IP address, right? Now, if you have events data, right? Event data, that is proxy log, which include the IP address, for example, abcaa.b.c.d. And if you want to enrich the host name details along with that in that proxy logs or those event data, in that case, what we're going to do, we're going to use this CSV lookup where we have both IP address and the host name, right? And whenever we enrich that proxy log with this along with the username and username, we'll also get its IP address and its associated host name, which will be very useful during an investigation or while performing a search on specific information. Okay, moving forward, as I mentioned, the lookups, whenever a search is executed, there will be a multiple operation that will be performed. In this case, if you see, the lookup has a specific sequence or it follows a specific sequence whenever we have multiple operations to be performed. So let's say when you're running a query, right, you might have an eval command. You might have a key field extraction which you are doing, right? In that case, first a key field extraction will be operated, then your calculated field, and then the lookups will be operated, right? So depending upon what search query you have written, the result might come faster or slower based on the sequence in which the lookup is gonna be processed. Hope you will understand what is a search time operation sequence that we have. I'm going to provide you a link which basically explains about the search time sequence and you can have more details about it. Okay, moving forward. So now let us understand what is lookup table files, what is lookup definition, and what is automatic lookup. So lookup table files are nothing but the tables file which contains a table with rows and columns. Splunk uses this lookup table files or lookup table to enrich or add external data which is meaningful to the event data by pulling the data from the respective lookup tables. Okay, I hope I said a lot of keywords. So let me phrase it again, rephrase it, the definition of lookup table files. Splunk uses the lookup table to enrich or add to the event data by pulling the fields out of the lookup table. Okay, so hope you've got a clear understanding what is lookup table files. They are just an external source which is used to enrich the event data. Next, what is lookup definition? A lookup definition is basically a lookup name, okay, and a specific path which is provided to a lookup table. Okay, lookup definition can include extra settings such as matching a specific rules or restrictions. You can filter out events, and then you can also and there's one key thing is that one lookup table can have multiple lookup definition, right? Let's say that I am creating a lookup table XYZ, right? I can associate that lookup table with multiple lookup definition, right? You'll have a clear understanding when we do the hands-on. All lookup types that we have gonna create will require a lookup definition, right? Now there's additional things that we have which we're gonna see in the hands-on, that is called as the time-based lookup. Or configuring the time, we will configure the time-based lookup. Next we have is automatic lookup. During the hands of when I've explained you the lookup table definition or lookup table files, you see that you have to manually add this lookup names or lookup tables name in a search query to enrich the data. But what if we can remove this manual thing and we can automate that event data with the enriched data without doing any activity, right? Or without manually adding any commands in the search. So we're going to see how we can do that automatic lookup. Okay, great. So this slide I'm keeping because I'm going to create a second part of this lookup where I'm going to discuss about external lookups, KV store lookups, and the geospatial lookups. In today's session, we are going to concentrate more on the CSV lookups. Okay. So let's quickly jump on to the hands-on. Okay. So I've already installed my Splunk and I'm going to use some specific data that I already have for creating a lookup. Okay. Okay. Let me quickly show you what data I have and how I'm going to use the lookups to enrich that data. Let me start with a basic example. I have some data set which I have pulled from this Splunk website, which I'll provide a link in the description. Okay. And for a simple example, I'm going to initially use this method so that it will be easy for you to understand. And then I'll show you some advanced examples. Okay. So if you see, we have tutorial data, which consists of multiple source type. We have some secure data, access combined cookie, and vendor sales. We are going to concentrate more on the vendor sales today. And then we're going to see how we can enrich the vendor sales data. If you see the vendor sales data, let me first run this into the verbose mode, okay, so that we can see what all fields that has been extracted from this. If you see, there's nothing much in the data. In each line or in each event, what we get is a timestamp, a vendor ID, a code, an account ID. And this looks that we don't have enough information to basically conclude anything. Or let's say that if I want to find, okay, this code B is for what? Is it for specific product or is it for specific vendor? We have a vendor ID here already. So what this code is for? So, right. So we're going to enrich this data with product name and other fields, right? Which I'm going to show you in a moment, right? And let me show you the lookup that I'm going to use. So I told you lookup table files are nothing but the external sources files, right? And in this case, I'm gonna show you the CSV based lookup. So I'm gonna use a lookup file table called as vendors.csv, right? So let me show you what kind of data do I have in this. If you see, I have vendor city details, vendor ID, latitude, vendor longitude, vendor state provenance, country, and weight, right? Okay, I don't have the product details, but I have the vendor details here, right? So, for example, if you see, and I told you, there should be something common, very similar to the primary key, right? So that we can basically enrich this event data which we already have in the Splunk. So in our case, if you see the vendor ID, right, we can see the same data which is available in the, okay, so as you see, we have this vendor ID which is common, and we're going to use this basically to enrich the data. But let us see how to create lookups and how we can use this CSV to enrich this event data. Okay, so for that we need to go to settings and then go to lookups. I told you that lookups are always associated with three things: lookup table files, lookup definition, and automatic lookups. If you see the definition provided by this Splunk, it says list existing group tables or upload a new file. Lookup definition is basically it gives you the existing lookup definition, or we can define a new file based or external lookup. And automatic lookup is used to create the lookups automatically. So let's create a lookup table files first. So I'll go create a new lookup table file. Destination app.php search, I leave it default and click on browse, and let us go to our vendors.csv, which is here, and then I'm gonna select the vendor search.csv CSV file, and then I'm gonna open it, right? So as you said, it says either a plain text CSV or a gzipped CSV or a KMZ or KML file, right? And the limit is 500 MB. Now the destination file name should end with CSV if you are uploading a CSV file, right? If you see here, it is clearly mentioned if you are uploading a gzipped CSV file, enter the file name ending with gz. If you are uploading a plain text CSV file, then we need to end it with .csv. Okay, so let me give the same name here, vendors.csv, right? We're good. Now click on save. So once we save it, it automatically create a lookup table file. So if you see, this is our lookup table file. Now if you focus on this, it says that it is created under the users, admin, search, and lookups file, right? And the other lookup tables are stored in etc apps. It is stored in etc users, right? So if you see, once I change the permission of this, let me zoom a bit. Once I change the permission of this lookup files, the path will, or the scope of this lookup will change. So let us, for that we need to go to permissions here, click on all the apps, and give read permission to the admin, read permission to everyone, and give write permission to the admin, and click on save. So now if you see, the path has modified, right? The scope of this, now instead of etc users, now it is will be stored under the path etc apps search lookups vendors.csv. So let me show you where it exactly resides. So I'll go at the back end. Let me go to opt Splunk, where my Splunk is installed. And if you see the path, right, we have to go to cd, we have to go to etc, and then apps folder, right? And since I've given this scope while creating a lookup table as search, it is being stored in the search application. You can see the list of application that we have here. So if you see, we have our search application here, right? So let me go to that application. And now if you see, it will be stored into the lookups folder, right? We have a lookups folder here. So let me do cd lookups, and we will be able to see our vendors.csv file, right? So it is created on August 30th, that is today, and vendor.csv file, right? So if you want to see whether my lookups has been created or not and where it is created, either you can check this path, or basically you can go to the specific application where you have created the lookups, and you can verify it. Okay, great. So now once the lookup table has been created, right, so let me show you a very simple command through which you can see what data that you have in your vendors.csv. you don't, now since we have already loaded on the Splunk, there should be a way through which we can see those data. So there's a simple command called as input lookup, and then you have to give the name as vendors.csv. The time doesn't matter here, you can give 5 minutes or 10 days, but it'll show you the same data whatever we have loaded into the lookup, right? So if you see, I have the similar data stored loaded here, vendor, vendor city and vendor ID and so on, right? Remember that every time this command, input lookup command, or basically all the generating commands should be starting with your pipe, right? Okay, cool. So now we have input lookup and the respective data here, right? We can see the input lookup. So now you understood the input lookup command is basically used to see the data. There are other methods or there are other usage also, which I'll show you in a few moments, right? So now we have completed the lookup definition. Let's go back. We have created a lookup table files. Now let's go back and create a lookup definition, right? As I told you, lookup definition is basically used to define a name to the Splunk. Okay, we'll go click on new lookup definition, and the destination app will be searched, and I'm gonna give the name. Now you can give any name. I'm gonna give vendors without .csv now, and it is of course a lookup. It's a file based lookup, right? So I'll just go and click on file based lookup, and then I'll look up that file. So now vendors definition is being provided for the lookup file vendors.csv. I told you about the time based lookup which we can perform, but since this lookup doesn't have any time field, right, this is not going to apply on that. I have another example for you where I'm going to show you how you can configure the time based lookup, and we at the same time we're going to see the advanced option of the lookup definition, right? So now great, so now we have all the fields that we needed to create a lookup definition, and click on save now. So once you click on save, you will have your lookup definition here. So now if you see, for the lookup definition vendor, you have these fields, which is nothing but these are the same fields which I have in my vendors.csv. Okay. So now if you see again, this is currently under the purview or under the scope of admin. So let's go to permission and change it from private to global. So click on all the apps and click on read, give everyone the read permission and write permission only to admin, and click on save. Okay, so now if you see, the permission is global now and it is under the search. Okay, great. So now we have created the lookup table. Now we create the lookup definition. So now let's see how you can use the lookup definition now. Okay, so now here comes the command which I've explained you in, which I've shown in the PowerPoint, called as lookup command. Okay, and here come the concept of the primary key, which was explaining with the help of the SQL query language. So now what you have to do is write your initial query, right? Okay, the primary search query which I've written, because I have to enrich my vendor ID source type, basically my vendor sales source type. So I've written that initial primary query, search query, and then I'm going to give a pipe, and then I'm going to write a lookup. Okay, so lookup has a specific definition. Basically the lookup should be written a specific way. So lookup should have lookup, and then lookup name, and then the field value which is common in event data and the lookup, right? And then you have further command like output new, right? I'll explain you what is output and input new and how does this works, right? So hope you're clear. This is the syntax of the lookup. So it should be lookup, the lookup file name or the lookup definition that we have given, and then the field value which is common in the event data, that is this data, and the lookup table, and then finally we're gonna output the data using either output or output new, or there's a default way of doing it. Okay, so let me show you that. So what you need to do is you have to go type lookup, and what is the lookup name? It's vendors, the lookup definition that we have created, right? You can confirm if you want to go to lookup definition, and then you have this vendors here, right? vendors, and then what is a common field between the event data and the lookup? If you see, vendor ID is the common field, right? So let me type vendor ID. So what's gonna do, based on this common value, it gonna enrich the remaining data that we have in the lookup. That is, the remaining data is vendor city, vendor country, latitude, longitude, state provenance, and weight. Great. So now if I say lookup vendor ID, right, and then click on the search, so let's see what do we get. So now if you see my event data, which is source type vendor underscore sales, has been enriched with additional data like vendor city, vendor, the vendor name, the vendor country, latitude, longitude, and the way of that country. Okay, now you can simply do remaining command, like if you want to see the vendor and then vendor ID, and then you can simply copy the vendor city. Similarly, vendor country, right? And we can see the data now. So now, once the data is enriched, you can perform any additional command or any further command that you want to do based on the data, or you can write any kind of query that which you want to perform based on the existing data, that is this one, right? So now, great. So what we have information now, vendor ID 5036 is in city Bilbao, country Spain, and the vendor is No Parson. The vendor name is No Pazaran, right? Okay, great. So now, how can we use, now let's say that, now if you see that here, all the lookup tables along with the all the column names along with the vendor ID has been enriched with the in the event data. Now let's say that I don't want all the fields, right? I just want the columns vendor city and vendor country, right? So in that case, I can use the command call as output, and then I can say what fields I want. I want the vendor city and the vendor country. Okay, or let's say I want the vendor also, right? The name of the vendor, and then I can run this search. So now if you see, whenever you get a result, you will see that you have only three fields now, additional data which has been enriched in the event data, that is vendor, the vendor city, and vendor country, right? The remaining fields has not been enriched, that is latitude, longitude, province, the way, right? So in this way also you can utilize the lookups. Now the same result can be achieved by typing output new command. Okay, output new. So when you type lookup vendors ID and the output new, and the same fields which you want to output into or enrich the data with, you can simply get the same result by using the output new also. So if you see, I have only vendor city and vendor country. So now you need to understand what is ideally the difference between output and output new. Okay, so let's say that I am trying to, based on the vendor ID, I am going to get the data which is called as code, right? So if you see, the code is already available here, right? So now if I just do output code, so what it's gonna do is it will pick up the data from the lookup, and it's gonna replace whatever the values that you have in the event data under the field code, right? So this can be, it becomes really difficult, because you might want this data also which you have the event data, and then you might want the code that is there in the lookup also. Like basically you want to append that data, you don't want to replace the data. In that case you have to use output new. So what will happen, you will have the event data code also, and additionally it will add a new field from the lookup called as code, okay, using this specific command called as output new. Okay, so hope you have got an idea what is lookup, how does the lookup command works, what is the syntax of it, and when do we have to use output and output new. Okay, so now Going to the third thing, that is called automatic lookup. So now if you see, every time if I want to enrich this data, right, I need to add this lookup, I need to write this command. It's not like once you write this command, it automatically will be populating every time. No. Now if you see, if I remove this command, lookup command, now there will no enrichment of data. It will just be again code, vendor ID and the account ID, right? We don't have any vendor name, vendor country, vendor city, right? So since we're going to use this data every time and it can be useful every time, so what we're going to do is we're going to automate this enrichment of data. And how do we do that? We do that by going back to our lookups. So we'll go to the lookups and then we'll go to the automatic lookup section. In the automatic lookup, we'll go and click on new automatic lookup. Right, and then I'm gonna give a name to this automatic lookup. Let me say I say vendors auto underscore vendors. Right, so this is the name of my automatic lookup, and then I have to give the lookup table name, that is vendors here. Right, it's gonna take the, based on this definition, it's gonna give the information. And now I need to apply. Now I have to tell the, in the configuration, I need to tell on which source type I need to apply. You can either give use source type, host or source, right? Either based on either of these, you can do the automation of the lookup. So in this case, let us go and pick up my source type. My source type is vendor underscore sales. I'll come and paste it here, right? So now based on the source type vendor sales, I want to enrich the data. So now in this case, you have to give which field you want to, which is the primary key here, right? The common field, which is common between the lookup table and the event data, you need to mention that here, right? So on the left hand side, you have to mention the field name which is available in the lookup table, and that is common, that is vendor ID here, right? So I will copy this name. In our case, they both are same, so we can just have the same names. But remember, the left hand side basically is gonna tell is the field name which is present in the lookup table, and on the right hand side is the field name which is available in your event data, that is this data, right? Okay, so now, so we have told, okay, based on this primary key or based on this common field, we need to enrich the data. So what are fields that you want, right? Let's assume that I want same vendor, vendor country and the vendor city. So I can say again on the left hand side, I have to give the field name which is available in the lookup table. So I'll go and give vendor name here. Let's say I want to give this in the lookup, in the enriched data. Whenever it is enriched in the Splunk, it should be coming as vendors underscore name, right? And now I want the vendor city. I think this name is fine, and I want in the Splunk log also to have the vendor city, or let's see, I will say vendor underscore city, right? And then I'll add the vendor country. So left hand side will be your field name or the column name from the lookup, and the right hand side is the field name or the field name that you want into your event data, right? So this should be country, right? So it is vendor country, right? So now I'm going to automate the enrichment of the data by, based on this common field, and I'm gonna add these three fields, right? If you say the name says lookup output fields, right? Now click on save. So now if you say, see clearly, it says the automatic lookup name is used for vendor underscore sales source type and the lookup field, right? What is going to look up? It's going to look up, it says clearly, it just given the names, right? It's going to look up the vendors where the vendor ID is renamed as vendor ID itself, and the output same command, right? I'll show you. Let me show you this. Let me copy this path and then I write it here, right? And I'm gonna say lookup same. Now if you see, it becomes the same command which I was just explaining you, lookup the lookup name, the common field that we have, and it's going to be renamed at the same thing. And then what all output we want, we want vendor, which is going to which will be renamed as vendor underscore name, vendor city, which will be renamed as this, right? So let me run and show you. So if you see, now I have three different additional field, that is vendor underscore name. Now see, the name has changed. It's not vendor, it's vendor underscore name, then vendor underscore country and vendor underscore city, right? So now, instead of writing this command every time when you want to perform any activity on this data, what we can do, we can automate, which have already did it, right? So let's see what will happen if I don't write that command and I simply search for index of tutorial, and the source type should be this. When I run for this, if you see, I'll automatically have this data enriched without doing any lookup command. I have vendor country, I have vendor city, and I have vendor. Okay, great. So I hope you are clear with all the three aspects, all the three aspects of lookup which have explained: what is lookup table files, lookup definition, and automatic lookup. All right. So now one command is still which I want to tell you, that is output lookup. How we have to use output lookup? Let's say the result that you have, right? Let's say I have a result where I have the vendor underscore name, vendor underscore city, and vendor underscore country, right? So let's say that okay, this should be capital N, and let me say I want to store the vendor. I want to list the vendor ID also, right? So I have done a table based on the vendor name, vendor city, vendor country, and vendor ID. Now there's a requirement that has come to you, and you have been asked that I want this to be stored into a different lookup, this specific data where we have vendor name, vendor city, vendor country, or vendor ID. So in that case, what we can use output lookup, and then I can say directly the output lookup name. Right, in the output lookup you have an option, right? If you want to append, you can say, let's say that you already have some data in the lookup. Let's say, for example, okay, before going to append, let's say that I want to store this data into the name call as, let's say, vendor underscore two. If you don't have this already, it will create a new one. Okay, let me say this as vendor two.csv, and when you click on search, right, it's going to give the same results, but at the back end, it's going to store all this data into your vendor underscore doop.csv. Let's see how we can see. Simply we'll go and search for vendor underscore doop.csv. Vendors. Okay, it's vendor underscore doop, not vendors. So let me remove this S and then search for it. Let me close this and search for this now. Right, so it is because of the cache. So now if you see, now I have vendor underscore doop.csv file here, right? So the output lookup command is used to store your data into another lookup table files, right? Let's say that whenever you run this search, it will be replacing that file. Now let's say that no, I don't want to replace that file, I want to append that file. In that case, I'm going to use append equal to true. Right? In that case, it's going to append the additional files. Okay. Let me show you the syntax of the output lookup or other keys that we have along with the command, along with the append. So if you see, I have append, right, in the syntax, and then you have the file name, then you have the output format string, what kind of output format you want, whether you want a string or boolean or whatever, and then you have max command and so on, right? So yeah, so you can test this out, the different ways through which you can get the details. I'll try to create a one more session showing the advanced showing the advanced query on the lookups, right? Okay, great. Now, as promised, I'm gonna show you an advanced method of using the lookups, right? So let us, for that, I'm gonna use a different index for that, right? So that is index is equal to blue code. So in this index, I basically have all the proxy logs, right? So let me run this only for last 5 minutes, let's say. It's a huge data, so it's going to take a lot of time. So let me run only for 5 months. Okay, I should not be doing real time. Let me change this to relative. Okay. So now, if you see in this index is equal to blue code, I have data where I have extracted a specific field called as source. Okay. And then there are other fields which I've extracted, but let us, we are going to concentrate more on the source now, right? So this source consists of all the IP address on which, based on which we have the logs. If you see, it has both internal and external IP address, right? Let us see, consider a scenario where you want to create a rule, okay, based on the threat intel which you're gonna push from which either you're gonna get from the Threat Connect, or you have the open source threat intel like abuse.ch or VirusTotal and so on, right? So I've already pulled a threat intel based on the IP address from the abuse.ch. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna see what all events that we have, or what all events that we have where we have seen a match to those suspicious IP address. So basically I'm trying to identify if there is any event in which a user has connected to a malicious or suspicious IP, right? So we are going to achieve that by uploading the lookup table, right? We are going to upload a lookup table which is basically based on the threat intel, that is threatintel.csv, and then I'm going to match, I'm going to write a query so that we can see which all IP address or the users are basically connecting to that specific malicious IP. Okay, great. I hope you're excited. So let's go to the settings again, and then let us add our lookup table files, that is threatintel.csv. So we go to new lookup table. The same activity that we need to do. I go back to my documents. I upload my threatintel.csv. And let me give the name as threatintel.csv. Okay, and save it. Once it's saved, let us go and change the permission from the, where is that? Yeah, from the users to the application scope, and it see if it's private. I want to make it global, so I'll go to permissions again. I'll give read operation to everyone and write only to the admin. So once I do, I can go back to my input lookup into the search and reporting gap, and then I search for threatintel.csv and let's see what result we get. So if you see, I have three columns here, or three fields. What is first seen, second is destination, and third is the destination port, right? So I'm gonna match this IP address. These are all malicious IP addresses, right? All suspicious IP address, and I'm gonna see which all events have this have a match to this suspicious IP address. Okay, let us quickly do that. So for that, I'm gonna do is I'm going to add a pipe, and then I'm going to search, right? I have my data already. Then I'm going to search the lookup. How going to do that? Using the input lookup. I'm going to say input lookup. I'm going to say, okay, threatintel.csv. List only the dest field, right? So now what will happen? Let me show you how does it work first. Let me copy this search and go here and paste it. So whenever you run this command, it will only show you the destination fields, right? So now these destination fields I'm going to match with the IP address field which is under the source. So now when the output comes from this search, right, the output of this and the field that we have in this index, right, under which our IP address is stored, that is source, so they, the name should be common, right? Then only it will be able to match the IP address which is common between the index data or the event data and the lookup data. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to rename the test as source, right? So now if you see, I'll get the result of all the IP address again, but under the field name source. Now what I'm going to do, now I'm going to copy this part and I'm going to store under the search field here, and then I'm going to close the bracket. Now if you see what I'm doing, I'm looking for the index is equal to blue coat, and then what I'm doing, I'm matching the data with the input lookup 13.csv with the specific field dest. And since the dest, we don't have any field called dest in the event data, I'm renaming the dest as source because the IP address is stored under this field, right? And then I'm gonna say table source, right? And then I can say, let's say that I want username and user agent, right? So I'll say user agent and then username, right? So I want to find the result where I want to find which is the user who is contacting the suspicious IP, the user agent which is involved in that, and the source, right? I can pick up basically the categories also. So let me see if I have the category. Yes. So let me say that I want the result of the category also, right? So let me search for this 5 months, right? Great. So if you see, now I have this data. This all IP address is basically the one which are there in this threat intel, and they have been communicated. We don't have any username captured, but they have been communicated under by Mozilla user agent and another category web advertisement. So let us see if whether this field is there or not. So for that, what you can do, just copy this and let us go and search. Okay. Search test equal to this. So we are seeing whether the result that we're getting is accurate or not, or we're just validating the result. So I'm saying that 45.0.0.83 is a value under the test field into the threat intel, and that's why it has matched with the event data where a user has connected to this. Okay, so we can, let me see, do we have this IP address or not. Great, right? So this has been in the threat intel field, and this has come on 16th August, that has been first seen. Okay, so this is great. So now we have identified successfully that we have few events or data where a user is trying to connect to the malicious IP, right? So this is an advanced method through which you can utilize the input lookup to get your result. Okay, so now as I promised, let's go back and see how we can configure the time-based lookup. For that, we have to define a lookup definition. We'll go to the settings, go back to the lookup definitions, add a new definition, and let me give the name as same, threat intel. It's a file based lookup, so I'm going to select my file based on which I'm going to create a lookup definition. And now if you see, I'm going to configure the time based lookup. Why I'm configuring the time based lookup? Because I have now time in my lookup field, right? I have a time field. I have a field which has the timestamp in the lookup field. So that's why I'm going to configure the time-based lookup. So now it is asking the name of the field. Which name of the field? For the time-based lookup, specify the name of the field in the lookup table that represents the timestamp, right? So in my case, the first seen is the column name which is representing the timestamp. So I'll go to the settings, give the first seen. Next, it is asking you to provide the time format. Time format should be in the strp time format of the timestamp field, right? This is basically the time format, which basically, so in our case, so what is saying specific strp time, it is saying specify the strp format of the timestamp field. So timestamp field, what do we have? We have first year, month, and then day, and then hour, minute, second, right? So we need to first, and then we have hyphen in between, correct? So we need to write in the same format. So first need, we need the year and then hyphen, then we need the month, then hyphen, and then we need the day, right? So we got year, month, day, and then we have hour, minute, second, and in the hour, minute, second, we have the colons. Okay, so we are good. So now we have the time format in year, month, day, and hour, minute, second, right? So the next thing that you have is minimum offset second and the maximum offset second. Okay, so let me try explaining you. So you can consider minimum of the maximum offset as the earliest time, right? And the minimum offset as the latest time, or the period of time at which the bound that I'm creating, I want to create for last 1 month till now. So I'm going to give the maximum offset time as 1 month in terms of seconds. So I've already calculated it should be 30 days multiplied by 86,400 seconds. So that will give me 25,092,000 seconds, right? Great. So now I've given my bound, time bound, which is from the current till minus 1. I hope you're clear. Now in the advanced option, basically you can give minimum number of matches that you want. Default is 0, but we need at least 1 minimum matches. Maximum matches, you can say, okay, you have a requirement where I want to say that, okay, if I have only 5 matches, then only I want it to be, basically if I have minimum 1 and maximum 5 matches, then only I should get the trigger. Or it can something, let's say that from 5 to 10. So if I have minimum 5 matches and maximum 10 matches, then only I should be enriching that event data, or I should be basically getting an alert based on whatever your goal is. Default matches, you want a case sensitive match or case sensitive match, you can provide it. Then you can also give a match type here, right? You can give a comma and space delimited fields, for example match type, then comma field name, and so on, right? And then you have the filter lookup, so you can basically filter it out. Let's say that you don't want all the data, you want only that, let's say that you have both error log and the warning log, and you want to send only warning log. In that case, you can filter that out, right? So I'm not gonna set up any advanced option. I'll try to create a separate video on this, because it's gonna take a longer time for that. But right now I'm gonna I've shown you how to do a time-based lookup, and then I'm click on save. So once I save, it's gonna create a lookup definition that is set into here, and then I'm gonna change the permission from private to global, that is read everyone and write only admin, and click on save. Okay, so here the minimum offset is 0 and the maximum offset is 1 month. So the time bound that we have is 1 month until now, right? So this implies the lookup will match the events with a timestamp, right? The lookup will match with the event with a timestamp that falls within the range of time bounded by the event timestamp and 1 month before the event timestamp, right? So this minimum and maximum offset is based on the event timestamp. So the lookup will match that specific event timestamp and 1 month before that timestamp. So anything which falls within the 1 month range of the data, it is going to show you, right? So now as we go here, right? So when I let's say that when I search table underscore time source and category, and when I run it for 5 months, what I get is the result that we have here, right? The event timestamp is here 6th May. So any data which falls from 5th May, sorry, this is year, month, day, right? So it is 5th, yani May month. So anything which falls within April month to May month will be giving the results here, right? I don't have any matching data with the last 1 month, otherwise it would have come here also, right? So if you see now, it is matching the data which is at 21:29 also. It is matching a data which is on 5th May also. So in this case, if you see, 45098, it is on 5th May 1622. All 1622, if you see 450120, it is on 3rd May, and they are all on 3rd May. Let it be different timestamp, right? So it is going to take everything. So hope you are clear how to configure the time based lookups and how do we get the required result. So now I'm ending the session with a note that I'm going to come back with the data, with the other types of lookups that we I've already told you. I've already completed CSV lookup. I'm gonna work on, I'm gonna provide you sessions based on the external lookups, KV store lookups, and geospatial lookups. Great. So hope you would have liked this session. Let me know if you are looking for any other topics related to lookups, or if you have any doubts, please let me know in the comments and I'll try to respond to you as soon as possible. Have a great day.